everyone, and welcome to this webinar marking the publication of the 361 Classical Acupuncture Points, names, functions, descriptions, and location. Just to give you a bit of an idea of how this is going to work, it's going to last about an hour. We're going to hear from the author, Stuart Lightbody, who will give us a little bit of background on acupuncture in the West, and also tell us about his new publication. And we'll learn about this book with the help of a live demonstration by a very kind volunteer, Stuart's wife, Ruth. At the end, there will be a short time to ask any questions you might have. So just ask them at any point during the event in the chat on Zoom. First of all, I'd just like to give you some housekeeping rules. The most important thing is, please could you make sure that your camera is off and also that you're muted for the whole of the event. I've already mentioned asking questions. And just a quick reminder that the session is going to be recorded and so will be available to the public afterwards. So all that I need to do now is to introduce you to our author, Stuart Lightbody. He's a member of the British Acupuncture Council. He holds a licentiate, bachelor, and master's qualifications from the College of Traditional Acupuncture, where he later taught. He was the director of the Halifax Clinic of Natural Medicine from 1979 to 2017, and ran an acupuncture clinic in southern Ecuador in 2008. Among his other travels, Stuart has participated in the China study tour to the College of Traditional Chinese Medicine in Chengdu. And there he first visited the Forbidden City, later inspired his book, The Forbidden City and Its Correlation with Classical Acupuncture in the Human Body. Stuart has written several books, and today I think it's time for me to hand over to him to tell us about his most recent publication. Over to you, Stuart.
Good, thank you, Natalia. Hi, everyone from around the world. I know it's early in the States and Canada. I know it's very late in Australasia. And I think it's a reasonable time in Singapore and Asia. I think that's around about 9 o'clock in the evening. So it makes it a bit easier for you. But thanks for everyone to be here. As I try and present my background and introduce the book to you, and also to treat and diagnose my wife Ruth. It is a bit weird here and around the world with this lockdown. I'm in Yorkshire in the UK, and we're in semi-lockdown. And it is a difficult time for everyone, for practitioners. They have to wear the full gear, even the latex gloves on your fingers, and that makes it nigh impossible to take the pulses. So it's a difficult time, but it will change. So just a little bit of background to me and my studying of acupuncture in the West, as I think this is relevant, as it was a bit crazy in those days, and now it's so much more together with the colleges now. So I first had acupuncture treatment in Australia whilst I was living in New Zealand in 1975. I had one point done on me in Sydney in Australia, the famous stomach 36. And having had that point done, it triggered something in my mind. I thought, what is this? What's this? And I returned to New Zealand and met somebody, a Chinese lady who just returned from the UK, who knew somebody who was studying. So to cut a long story short, I returned to the UK and enrolled in 1976 at the college in Leamington Spa under J.R. Worsley. And yeah, in those days, it was a bit strange. There was a lot of strange terms, strange names. We got together once a month at a weekend, and it was most inspiring time But there were a lot of difficulties with learning that I found. I was probably bottom of the class, to be quite honest. I remember one point they were taught could treat illusions of grandeur, stuff like that. And we were given information in Chinese of the points, and nobody understood what they actually meant. So occasionally it all a bit misfired, but there was this wonderful feeling of trying to understand this wonderful system of medicine and to bring it into the public domain. I mean, even the registrar of the college, Miss Twig at the time, she would, you know, give us credit to pay for the course because we were all a bit broke in those days. And I know it's all different now. I know the colleges are so much more together, so much more organized, producing really very confident and experienced students. I can't say that I was one of those when I finished my course, but I went straight on to do the bachelor course. And with that course came the American students, which added quite a lot of vigor to the course. It was the time of the AIDS epidemic, which was a bit of a scary time. It's a bit reminiscent now of those times. And in fact, we had a patient from San Francisco with us who was the lasting patient in that city, being really treated with classical acupuncture. A couple of years later, 1984, I attended the China study tour organized by some English people. Claude La, who is a wonderful teacher, came with us. He's published a lot of books through Monkey Press, and it was wonderful to have him on board during that study tour. He was 40 years he spent in China. He was a Jesuit priest and was very inspirational and a wonderful person. And the students on the tour were from different colleges of acupuncture, those that practice traditional Chinese medicine, TCM, the five elements, which was my upbringing, and stems and branches. Those were the three main colleges in the UK teaching, you might say, proper acupuncture in those days. There was a little bit of tension between the different colleges in the 70s. Our system is better than yours. And after many years, we realized that is not the case. We need as much help as we can to bring the proper service through our treatments to the patients. I know that applies to me. I have studied TCM, but my main approach is the five element approach. I then went on to do a master's degree again with the Americans. And by that time I started to feel a little bit more confident. And really since those days, it's been wonderful to have had the opportunity to use this wonderful system to help the patients on the levels of body, mind, and spirit, particularly the deeper levels, which I feel apply particularly so here in the West. When I was in China, it seemed to me to be very much physical problems that were being treated, rather than mental, emotional, even the deeper levels, which are, I find, very much so here in the West. And so all these experiences triggered a seed in my mind to try to gather together the information that I'd learned from college, from what I'd experienced, and from some further research, and try to put it together in a clear way. And it's something that I would have liked whilst I was a student, particularly in the 70s, when it was there was nothing of the sort at all. I know there's some excellent books also on the points, but this one that I've put together gives, in one glance really, all the information that, all the basic information that is necessary. So you have, Natalia, could you put up the contents page, please? This gives you an idea of all the meridians, the 14 meridians that are covered, along with a glossary and notes and a bibliography, which you'll be able to see now, I think. And so, you know, on the left, you'll see on the PowerPoint, as I treat Ruth, you'll see a number of points laid out. So on the left, you have all the information on the points, including their names, which I always found fascinating. And then you have the common needle depth, the common number of moxas, a very detailed account as to how to find the point, and very accurate diagrams that show each point highlighted in red on the extreme right-hand side. I have to say that the drawing of the meridians, with wonderful help from two people, Dr. Leanne Langlois, who is a holds a doctorate in physiology, and is an acupuncturist in the Midlands in the UK, and Dave Pugh, who is a retired graphics teacher, has helped me so much to put these diagrams and the position of the points together. And that has taken us 5 years to do. It was many years before that that I was able to put down formally the information of the points, and gradually change that as I got more experience and try to be succinct with them. And particularly, I've left space in each point section so that students and practitioners can add their own observations, their own understandings, because I'm fully aware that this is information that I've put together. It's limited, but I feel it's of great value, but people have a chance now to add their own observations and understandings to see them through their practice. How I really see this book is as a big reminder. I often forget the needle depth numbers and moxas, and just to see a few comments on the effect of the points on the left-hand side just triggers it all in my mind, and then I'm fine. We do need to be reminded about important things in life, because for myself, at least, I forget so easily the most important things. And this applies to the book. It's just a big reminder for everyone. Now, fairly soon, I'm going to have Ruth, my wife, as the patient on the couch, and then I'll proceed to Natalia, I think the contents page can probably come down now. Thanks. And then I will start to look at her through the eyes of the five element diagnostic grid. That is the color, sound, and odor of the patient. I'll be checking her 12 pulses, and I'll be carrying out the Akabani test, which I'm sure some of you know about and others maybe not. This is a recent test described, I think, in 1953 or anyhow the middle of last century by Kobe Akabane, a Japanese practitioner of many years standing, who uses this technique to find out how, if there's any disparity between the left and the right-hand sides within each meridian. And I have always used this test, and I like to do it, and it gives me time to digest what the patient has told me in the initial interview that they've come with, and also for me to think about what treatments can then be brought about. And so I will do the full Akabani test as well. And speak a little bit about further diagnostic techniques that I use. And then I'll be treating Ruth referring to the book pretty much as always, just to remind me of certain things that I need to be reminded about, what the points do, and the depth and the number of moxas. And we'll have a PowerPoint presentation during that time, certainly of stomach 36 and spleen 3, because as you know, we are now, at least in England and in Europe, coming into the late summer, which is the time resonant with the earth element. So I'll explain that more as we go along. So I think what we'll do now, I've also put down that, using the book, you can see at a glance from left to right, all the information that you need, with the patient in front of you to refer to. And I find this really very helpful, as I hope you will too. So I think what we'll do now is, Ruth, if you could hop up on the couch, please. Jean, if you could perhaps either sit there or we'll do it.
And I think I'd better stand
next to it. Yeah, I mean,
I'll be better standing.
You will be, okay, that's fine. As I say, we're now in the late summer here, and this is the season that has resonance with the earth element. So I'm now going to have a look at Ruth's pulses to see how they are. And we'll have a look at these now. I always like to look at the fingernails as well to see the state of them, bearing in mind they're sort of an extension of the liver energy, and just gives me an idea of how things are within the patient. I know other practitioners have a different position for the pulses. This is how I was taught, and this is what I use, have always used over the last 40 odd years. But I know that people have their hand support on the couch, both hands, but I do it this way.
Excuse me.
Hello, yes.
Yes, I'm Mr. Lightbody.
Yes.
Any chance to enlarge your this screen so that we can see clearly?
Okay.
Just like the chat you showed just now, it was large.
Ah, was it? Are you? Do you want to go back a bit, Jean? Is that any better?
That makes it smaller, doesn't it?
Do you want to come further forward? Is that any better?
I've only got this little square. Only got this little square.
Yeah, well, that's all you've had anyhow, isn't there? Is that any better? The gentleman had asked a question. At least you can see what I'm doing, and then you might want to draw back a bit as well to give a bigger picture. You can see, or unless you go with the other side, maybe he can't quite see my positioning of my fingers.
I've got the big picture now.
You have? Done that? Oh, okay.
Now you got it, Mr. Light.
You got that? Okay.
Yes, we got it. Everybody got it.
Got it.
Thank you very much.
I don't know what did that.
I don't know.
No, it's the specialist did it, I think.
So I'm trying hard to focus here. So, which we have to do. We have to be focused and leave our minds outside the door. So I know I'm on a global video, but I'm trying to focus in here. Just 1 second. Okay, I've got that side. Jean, I'll just go to the other side. I need to get a bit more information here. As we all know, the pulses are so important, and just one has to be focused, and that's what I'm trying to do, just so I can get the understanding of what's going on internally. The pulses are so wonderful. Okay, I've got that. And then I tend to take the pulses quite often during the treatment. Before and after a treatment anyhow. But they give so much information to us, and I have great respect and love the pulses. Now, Just to talk about the diagnosis through the eyes of five elements, and as I said before, I will use the four methods of color, sound, emotion, and odor. And with Ruth, her color, as you know, can be seen around the mouth and around the eyes. Here is yellow. Her sound is singing. Her odor is fragrant, and her emotion is overly sympathetic, very much so, particularly with animals, I have to say. She will go to extreme levels to bring care and comfort to animals in general, and ours particularly. I have to say it drives me mad a little bit, but that is her thing. I don't have that level of sympathy. She will be up in the night with our dog and doesn't complain about it, whereas I do. But that is there within her. She also has, as a secondary point to mention, very strong interest in houses. We must have seen about 60 or 80 houses in Spain, and we haven't actually bought one yet. But so her big thing is houses. She often has houses coming up in the dreams. So these are little helpful secondary points that help me confirm what we term is the causative factor, or the CF of the patient. And of the five elements, her element most in need of attention is the earth element, and that, as you know, it contains or governs the stomach and the spleen energies. And I think of the two, I think it's the stomach which needs the most attention. I'm now going to do the Akabani test. If you don't use it, I have actually written an article in EJOM, European Journal of Oriental Medicine, in last month's magazine, explaining about this. So what it is, it's a little taper, and I'll be holding it quite close to some points, nail points, jingle points at the end of the fingers, on both sides, and I'm recording what I'm finding. So I'm going to do it quite quickly, and Ruth will then say hot when she feels the heat coming up. Here we go, honey. Just
hot. Hot.
That's fine. Thanks.
Hot.
Okay.
Hot. Hot. Hot.
So the secret is to keep it at the same distance away from the skin. It just takes a bit of time to get the hang of that, but it is pretty easy.
Hot.
Okay.
Hot. Hot.
It's the heart meridian now.
Hot. Hot. Hot.
Okay, those seem actually okay. Now I'm going to do the ones on the feet. I don't know where you can get, maybe that way, Jean, I think. So I'll just start on these. Here we go.
Hot. Hot.
Okay, so that's the first one that's out on the spleen, and out quite a long way. So that's great. And another one.
Hot.
Okay, so that's also out on the liver. Is that okay, Ruth? Jean, you're getting those in?
Yeah.
Hot. Hot.
Yeah, and also the stomach. Another one.
Hot. Hot.
A little bit there. Okay. I do like to do this test. I just feel the fact that you're balancing left and right hand sides is great to do. And the patient sort of understands that as well. The kidney point is on the inside of the nail. It's how you use this. Here you go, because the last one, as you know, is underneath the sole of the foot. Here we go, honey. Okay. Great. Okay, so that's good. We've got a number out there. Good. So we'll start off there. Then actually, we're on the right, so that's great. We'll now balance those. So just to refresh my memory. Just looking at my book here to remind me. Of the prince's grandson is the junction point of the spleen. So. So spleen 4 is the junction, passage, or low point. I think I'll need it straight away. So it's so I'm now just going to balance the spleen meridian up. My needle technique is that for tonification, it's in and out in a second. If I'm sedating, I leave it in. I know other practitioners, they will leave it in for both with a different manipulation. So I'm just going to treat spleen 4 now. Honey, I just need that little achy cramp, okay? Just a little achy cramp. Here you go. Got it. Okay. Great. Now, that's excellent. Okay. And I will be checking these with the taper when I've done them all. The dog is barking. What are we going to do about the dog?
Nothing yet.
I think we'll just leave it. Good. Okay. So I just need to. Let's get my. So we're now going to be doing the junction point of the stomach, abundant splendor, stomach 40. just check that in the book again. Just find me, yeah. Okay, so we've got the information abundance and we've got it here now. So again, honey, I just need the little achy cramp. So I'm feeding for the men, as we know. A little depression and a little achy cramp might run a little bit, honey. Here you go. Not quite. Did it feel to be near it? Another one. This is my measuring tape. We're very near it. So I'm near it, but I'm not quite on it. Probably a millimeter or two away. A little bit higher. There you go. Okay, that was it. Sorry. So I didn't get it first, and then we managed to get it on the third go. Sorry. And now I just need to also just check. Gallbladder pudding. My memory is going a little bit. It's very helpful to have this. Okay, so this is, got it, okay. Okay, great. So, bright and clear, the junction passage or low point of the gallbladder. And again, if I could just have that little achy cramp. Can you see it, Jean, there? You got me on there, yeah?
Okay. Yeah.
Looking for a slight run, honey. Did it go down?
Sorry. Down into my toes.
That's it. Sorry, that's that done. I didn't quite get it, and then we got it. So, well done. We're nearly through.
Not quite
yet. Well, that's happened. an honest reaction. I mean, you know, some people seem to do painless insertions, but I've never been able to manage that. Now, where have I put my notes here now? I have them in a second again. I've got to put them somewhere.
Are they on that chair?
This one. No, so they must be...
Are they under the book? No.
Strange. How can a thing disappear like that?
I don't remember.
Unless I've gone and put it on your
No.
Right, so I just need to... Where did I go and put it? Somebody's probably seen it on the camera.
I don't know. I wasn't paying attention, obviously.
They're not
on that.
No, it's not there. But I had it just
under the green thing.
Strange, isn't it? Okay.
It's a mystery.
Okay, so what I'm going to do now is to go now to the earth points, the seasonal points. Oh no, first I'm going to check that I've actually got these points now. So so we'll now recheck these. So honey, I want you to tell me when it gets hot again, please. So we'll see if these are now balanced. So if you just tell me when it gets hot, please.
Not.
Okay.
Hot.
Good, that's spot on. That was the most out, so that's fine. And the stomach as well. Here we go.
Hot. Hot.
Good, spot on, great. And gallbladder.
Hot.
Great, okay.
Hot.
Good, spot on, that's lovely, that's lovely. I mean, although they're minor, I always feel it's great to have them balanced up. Just because our whole idea of acupuncture, in my understanding, is balance and harmony within the energy system. However we do it, whatever diagnostic ways we work, is to balance that up, that internal energy system. And this helps with the left-right balance. And I always feel good with that. Now, I'm going to look at the two seasonal points now, the late summer points on the earth meridians, stomach 36 and spleen 3. And I'm going to tonify them because the pulse picture is a little lacking. It's a little thin and needs a little bit of strength brought into it. If it was overabundant, I would be sedating or moving it elsewhere to areas that needs the extra energy. But in this case, I just need to strengthen the system. And the perfect points for this are the late summer points. Where I use, if I were to use them between 7 a.m. and 11 a.m., they would be also horary points, the time of the day that resonates with the stomach and the spleen. Stomach 36 has got to be a favorite point of mine because it was the first point I ever had done on me in Australia in 1975, which was the trigger for me to be amazed at something like this and want to study it, really. And fortune provided me a way of contacts with people, of getting to a college that taught it. And in fact, some years after becoming a student, I read that in one of Richard Birchinger's books, if I remember correctly, on old treatise on the acupuncture points, that stomach 36 used after the age of 30 can change your direction in life. That's one translation of it. And I was 30 and a half at the time. And I just think that some guy in the 1300s had the same experience as me. Using this point can trigger that change in direction. Certainly happened to me. So let's try now just touch stomach 36. the famous stomach 36. Now, let me just check that I've got the depth right, so I'm referring to the book. And Natalia, if you would kindly put up on the PowerPoint now stomach 36, please. For a point which has such wonderful attributes, I always think that the translation from the Chinese to leg 3 miles doesn't really do it justice. as some points have 20 names to them. So it's just that little achy cramp, honey, if I may, please. It's a little ache. No, I didn't connect with that. I'm near it, but did you get anything at all?
No, near it.
Near it, yeah. I always like to get the patient feeling the point. This one more, you're doing great, but again, did it feel as though, oh, I see, I think I'm a little, hang on, let me just have a quick look at that again. Okay, I'm just a little bit too far in, I think, here, so with a bit of luck. There we go.
Ah.
Achy?
Yeah.
Great. Well done, well done. I'll just also now have a little look at pulses, which I should have done before, see how these are doing. That was reasonably clear, was it?
Yeah.
So that's nice. Okay, that's nice. By that I mean they've all woken up a little bit stronger on that side at least. And I'm going to check this other side. That's nice. That's good. So I'm now going to finish off with the earth point on the spleen, stomach, spleen 3. And Natalia, if you could put the PowerPoint onto spleen 3, please. We did have a pen. Using books and pens. Let's just have a look. So the earth point of the spleen, spleen 3. Check that I've got the okay, that's good. So I mean, you'll feel this a little bit, just, but it's an achy little ache that I'm after, and this is probably going to be the last one.
So a little ache, here you go. I mean, something, yeah, bit tender, yeah, sorry. Tender, but I think we got something with it. Not just the discomfort, yeah, you've got something with it. Yeah, okay. Right, let me now have a little look at the pulses again. Yes, good. Okay, that's nice. How are you feeling? You okay. Yeah. Well, don't say you're feeling not great because we're on camera here. So
smiling.
That's good. Yeah.
She's the dog has stopped barking.
Yes. Well, I knew you'd be worried about that. That's a sympathy. You know, that's you would have shot out and looked after that dog.
I'll appreciate you more when you go out.
Thank you, yeah. Yeah, these are nice. These are coming nice now. Yeah, more body to them, stronger. That's the thinness has gone out of them. That's lovely. I could just see one other side, thanks, Jean. Nice. So as always, drink plenty of water after the treatment. Watch for any changes if you can, please. Good or bad, any dreams popping up? Anything, any symptoms popping up? How your energy is, that sort of thing for the next feedback. Good, okay, so I think we've now done what I wanted to do, and we seem to be reasonably okay for time as well.
Is that all right if we move on to some questions?
Yes, so I think we're on schedule here, Natalia. So if there's any questions, thank you, Ruth, thank you. Still don't know where that paper went, but
no, I've no idea.
So I don't know if you've got any questions come through, Natalia.
Yeah, we do. First of all, thank you very much for that talk, plus the demonstration. Thank you, Ruth. So we've had some questions. Keep asking them in the chat. Well, could you say a bit more about traditional acupuncture and preventive medicine?
Yes, that's a good one. That's a good one. And it's so powerful, so wonderful. Everyone should have acupuncture for this reason, preventive. The highest form of medicine, from what I can gather. And this understanding goes back such a long way around the time of the unification of China, 221 BC, that you don't dig a well when you're thirsty, and you don't forge weapons when the battle is underway. It's too late. So that understanding was put in those poetic terms and applies, of course, to us today. So that, you know, the idea is not to get diseased, not to get ill, and acupuncture can afford a wonderful way of helping with this. I mentioned it before, by keeping the energetic system balanced, because by doing that, any seeds of disease, any assaults on the system, it keeps the roots from being put into the ground, and so that the disease won't get a hold. And acupuncture can do wonders for that. And I probably 40-50% of my patients come for preventive treatment, and that is about five times a year at the change of the seasons.
now we're in the late summer, which is the time of the stomach and the spleen. The winter, it's the autumn, it's lungs and colon. Winter, it's bladder and kidneys. Spring, it's liver and gallbladder. Summer, it's heart, small intestine, and pericardium, and the three heater resonate with these seasons. And so, you know, I would do very much what I've done today, check the pulses, see how the patient's been, check the acubanes, consider doing a seasonal treatment, and if possible, a horary treatment as well at the right time of day. And I feel by doing that, I'm supporting the patient's energetic system. You know, during the conversation, it may be that their lifestyle's gone a bit crazy, they're eating or drinking too much and of the wrong things perhaps. So it's always good to have that pointed out to them without any judgment. And so it has such a valuable place to play in a nation's keeping the nation's people healthy so that they don't get ill. I think it's a very important thing, and I have treatment in that way myself too, 4 or 5 times a year, and I find that very valuable, and I have done that for some decades now. Anything else at all, Natalia, that's come through?
Yes, we have a question from someone watching from Arizona, which is very nice to see.
Yes.
Over the time that you've been in practice, has there been an increase in demand in the West, and also the differences in use between the UK and China you mentioned, but in any of the other places that you've had clinics, have you noticed a difference in what you've had to?
Yes. Okay. I mean, in my day in the 70s, acupuncture was considered pretty weird, pretty strange. And certainly that's got a much, much more accepted. I still strongly feel it's nowhere near given the place that it should have in keeping the nation's people well. But it's come a long, long way. Nearly everyone knows about acupuncture now. And in the 70s, they sure didn't, and thought it was some sort of witchcraft or voodoo type approach. And I'm, you know, another reason I wrote the book is to try to bring some clarity, some acceptance, some further understanding of what this wonderful system of medicine can do. Going on to the other side, I do think, maybe not now, but in 84, what I was seeing in China was mainly physical symptomatology coming through, whereas in the West, it has always been mental, emotional, sometimes of a spiritual nature, actually. And as you know, the Neijing always talks about treating the patient. The Neijing was written 221 BC, and always talks of trying to treat the patient at the level of their spirit. But I think with the industrialization of China, and so many percentage of the people moving to the cities, I think this will now, the problems of the mental emotional side will become much more prevalent. I'm pretty sure that's the case. We'll see, but in 84, I didn't really see that, but I think now, so many years later, it is changing. So yeah, and acupuncture can address the physical, the mental, emotional, and the, as we know, the deeper spiritual aspects of a patient. Amazingly, it has its power to do that. So I just do think it's a wonderful system, and I feel privileged to have stumbled across it, really, and to be able to serve my patients in the best way I can, sometimes with success, sometimes not. But more with success, I have to say. More with success. Okay, are we just about through now, or we we got one more question.
We have some more questions, but we don't have time. I'm really sorry.
Okay, well, it is 3 o'clock, and I know you've got your schedule to keep to. So I'd just like to say many thanks to everyone around the world for tuning in. I hope it's been helpful.
Yeah, and I'd like to also say thank you to you, and also to Ruth and Jean with the camera.
Well done, yes. Yes, they're not getting paid for it.
Thank you to everyone who came to watch. I hope you found this as interesting and informative as I have. On your screen, you should see details about the discount code. So make sure you go to our website or follow the QR code on the screen, and just put that discount code in at the checkout. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.